This was brought to you by The Vine on YouTube and The Storyteller on Facebook. My mom had broken up my dad and older sister, who had gotten into a fight. My dad moved to Phoenix, my mom lost the apartment in Mesa, and the family had to move to Phoenix with my dad. My oldest sister decided she wanted to stay in Mesa with her boyfriend. I just got back to Arizona and found this out, which was all a shock. A family of five went from living in a two-bedroom apartment to a one-bedroom economy apartment in downtown Phoenix. The apartments were surrounded by a security fence with gates to get in and out of too. I could always get into the apartment complex though, without a key. The landlady's apartment and the apartment complex office were joined together. The office was located on the outside of the front gate to the apartments. In one of the windows outside of the gate, she had a window unit air conditioner. It was just under the edge of the walkway balcony on the second floor of the apartments. I would take a running start at the air conditioner, jump onto the air conditioner with one foot, then jumping again catch the edge of the second floor walkway with my hands. I would pull myself up, climb over the rail, and quickly go into the apartments. My landlady would hear a thump and walk outside to see what made the noise, but I was already out of sight. I was able to meet my dad's cousin, my second cousin, and he was a character. Being divorced and living in the apartments in downtown Phoenix, he was a recluse who kept to himself. He also had issues concerning doctors that eventually caused his death. He felt doctors knew nothing, and he could figure out cures for his illness. He would use strychnine and poisons as medicine that could kill you if taking them long enough. We constantly watched him, trying to make sure he wouldn't do the things he was doing. It was like he was addicted to killing himself, just as I was with drinking and doing drugs. Our landlady had a son who moved to Arizona from Indiana, just before I came home to live with my family from Illinois. He became friends with my family, eventually meeting my oldest sister, who also moved home after her relationship in Mesa failed. My sister and the landlady's son started dating. They also moved into an apartment together, and now they are married with three kids. Our landlady became the in-law, and later no longer ran the apartment complex in Phoenix. She retired due to cancer and moved to Illinois with the kids, my sister and her son. The kids, her grandkids, loved having her around, and she eventually went into remission from cancer. My oldest sister, her husband, and kids all moved to Illinois. Her son is now an over-the-road truck driver. My oldest sister raises the kids, and her mother-in-law helped out. They live on the same street where our grandparents were living. It's strange how things work out. Since writing this, my sister's mother-in-law had passed away. She didn't die because of cancer, she contracted a cold instead. When living in the apartments, I met my brother-in-law's cousins, and they were strange. Both were brothers, one lived in his apartment, and the other lived with his aunt, my brother-in-law's mother. We moved from the apartments to another complex on the northwest side of Phoenix, and I started school, learning cooling and heating. There was a rental dispute between our landlady, my sister's future mother-in-law, the new owner of the complex, and our family. The dispute was over the apartment complex, adding the utility bills to the rent each month. My sister and brother-in-law got married just after we moved out of the complex. I also met the girl whom I considered the first love of my life. I was still taking the bus back and forth from Phoenix to Mesa, and I met her at an arcade I frequented in Mesa. I was hanging out with friends, spending the money received from a stipend check, drinking alcohol, and taking cab rides to Mesa. Drinking in a friend's car, she was with me and told me she liked me, so I kissed her. The next day, I couldn't remember what she looked like, and it was only luck I made it back to Phoenix that night. I woke up and was on my way to meet her again. I got there, and to my relief, she looked good. The night spent in front of her apartment, during the weekend, our legs crossed over each other and talking about everything. I would spend weekends with her, her sister, and mom. Her mother let us sleep on the front room floor together, and we were always having sex. We would lay on the floor watching movies until everyone was asleep. We always had sex in strange places like parks, in my dad's car, or behind a bush, on the lawn of apartment complexes, in the middle of the day or at night. She would sit on my lap with a hole in her shorts, outside of her apartment door, and around the corner from her apartment. We were perverse animals, it seemed. When my sister and my now brother-in-law got married, she was my date, and I was the one who caught the garter belt. I gave it to her afterward, walked to the Phoenix Civic Center, and had sex on a concrete bench, at night, at the front door of the place. She was later diagnosed with cervical cancer, and had a miscarriage with my baby. That was the first of the most frustrating times in my life. Being young, I didn't know how to deal with the situation, so I dealt with it badly, and recently had to make amends for those behaviors. I was amazed because I thought I would never see her again. My friend who let me sleep in his closet would let me sneak into his house at night. I got into his room by walking across the top of his privacy fence, crawling onto his patio to his bedroom's sliding door window, and sneaking in. He and I were a perfect match. We were lazy as heck, sitting around playing Dungeons and Dragons, and we couldn't even play that game right, because we were too lazy to learn. There were too many rules and regulations, so we simplified it to our satisfaction. When I slept in his closet, I had to sneak in and hide in his closet. He would close his bedroom door, preventing his dog from coming into the room and attacking me. The dog was protective over the house, and I was able to see how protective he was one day. I was waiting in the closet, and a sheet was over the closet's door preventing anyone from seeing into it. Looking out from behind the sheet, I could see I had left the sliding door window open. Sticking my hand out and grabbing the door handle to close it, I heard growling. My friend had forgotten to close his bedroom door, and the dog was in the room. Seeing my hand startled the dog, and he saw me as a threat. My friend's sister came in and got the dog before he gained enough courage to attack whatever was in that closet. That was the last time I stayed in his room for the night. His mom wasn't happy with us. I was living in Phoenix, staying in Mesa, and walking around all night because I couldn't sleep. I would sometimes stay with my girlfriend and friends, but not very much. I met a kid who lived behind my girlfriend's apartment complex, whose mom was nice enough to let me stay with them. My new friend's family probably saved my life, but I did take advantage of staying weeks at a time. I am grateful to them. They were gracious to let me stay as long as I did. If I ever have a chance to tell them, I will. My Dungeons and Dragons friend went into Job Corps. After he had a heart attack and overdosed from cocaine. I was seeing my girlfriend and using my new friend for a place to sleep. I wrote a short story about my new friend's mom. I thought she was hot, and it came back to haunt me. A girlfriend I had dated was able to read the story, and told my friend about it after we broke up. She was a nice woman who talked to me, tried to give me suggestions. I was so full of youth and unwilling to listen to anyone though. My friend's mom gave me the best advice I had ever heard, even up until this day. She said, ex-girlfriends should stay ex-girlfriends. It didn't work out the first time for a reason. Those words stood out to me, but I never put action behind them. A girlfriend and I broke up for the first time, just before my friend's mom gave me the advice. I got my girlfriend pregnant, and she ended up being diagnosed with cervical cancer. Not trying to sound selfish, I see a lot of grief spared by taking the advice from my friend's mom. She told me why she felt the way she did about going out with someone twice too. She dated a boyfriend as a kid, from her hometown, had broken up with him, and moved away. After divorcing her husband, she traveled back home, and went out on a date with that ex-boyfriend. Remembering why they broke up, my friend's mom decided to end the relationship. He decided to wait until she was walking down a sidewalk, then tried to run her down. When I saw my friend's mom, she would come home with food, sit in the front room, and read books. Retiring to her room around 7 o'clock with her book and a couple of drinks. She had a daily routine. Her house was always clean and organized. It was the life that I had always dreamed of having. My friend came from a divorced family of three, For if you count his father, not including his grandparents, who were active in his life too. I looked up to his older brother as a role model, and his older brother thought I was a goofball, like most people in my life who knew me. I felt comfortable around him, and he once even let me and his brother go to a party with him and his friends. I made a fool of myself, and he was so embarrassed, but still treated me like a friend. I thought a lot of them, but slowly my friendship with the family would change. They didn't tell me to stop coming around, and that was amazing. After I was an 18-year-old, I continued to steal alcohol. My friend and I started drinking on his front porch, while his family was asleep in the house. One night my friend had too much to drink and thought he was dying. Soon he was crying in the front room and caught red-handed. His mom never told me not to come around anymore, and I continued to see the family until my parents were divorced and I moved to Illinois. I would love to find them. We have since lost touch, and I need to make my amends for the things I did. I am grateful they were a part of my life during one of its darkest parts. I had habits, rituals, and things I did in repetition daily. I stayed out for weeks at a time on the streets, picturing the party life and visualized what I was going to do. I walked around all night, taking the same route, sleeping on rooftops, and drinking when I could. At 17, my father tried to do something, attempting to change me. He co-signed school loans, and I started going to a trade school in Phoenix. I did good for a while. We moved out of the efficiency apartment downtown, into a bigger apartment on the west side. My sisters and I had to share a room, and my parents both slept in the front room. By this time, they no longer slept together, so they would sleep on separate couches. I got a few blankets and made a pallet in the walk-in closet, with a small black and white television. My sisters took the bedroom and shared the same bed. My brother slept in the dining room area off to the side of the kitchen. We had more space and lived in a complex without bars on the entrance. I had a few friends there, and the idea of partying never left my mind. I went to school and continued to drink while I went to school. I was friends with the landlady's son, and I had two other friends that lived in the complex. I also knew an older guy, who was crippled for being involved in a gang earlier on in his life, crippled from multiple injuries. He first lived in our apartment complex, but had to move into the apartment complex next to us. My friends and I knew a couple who lived a few blocks away. We would go to their house, or to our friend who was crippled to party. We had to go to the store, and help him carry everything home when we partied at his house. The couple wanted us around because they were entertained by us. My landlord's son was very restrained and seemed to not get caught up in all the things the rest of us were involved in. I had another friend from Michigan, and then a third friend who was quiet, and I never knew where he came from. Hanging out with these guys, I went to school and planned my weekends for visiting Mesa to see friends, and my girlfriend too. Instead of sleeping on rooftops, I stayed with my friend or girlfriend, who lived behind my friend's house in an apartment complex. In Phoenix, while meeting with my friend's girlfriend, the landlady's son, my other friends and I, drank all day with both of them. While we waited for her boyfriend in the alley just behind the apartment complex, all of us, his supposed friends, sat around his girlfriend, lifted her shirt, and licked on her tits. We did it while he was getting money for more alcohol, and never even felt bad about it. My friend from Michigan was outspoken, and was big, but not all muscular. He constantly wanted to get into fights, and cause trouble. My other friend was quiet and warned me to not get involved with my other friend's ideas, but I never listened. It was all about having fun at any cost, even my friends. My quiet friend was reserved too, but wasn't like my landlady's son in the same way. He went along with me and my other friend from Michigan, doing the same things. We three got into trouble, hung out with old drunk Indians, went to adult bookstores and sleaze shops, using tokens to watch women strip with the husband of the couple that we hung out with. They were most likely into the whole swinging scene, but I'm not sure. They never did anything with me. Not saying I wouldn't have messed around with her. At the time, the wife was a little chubby, but flirted a lot and carried herself well. One night while we hung out, they had a gag gift for one of my friends. It was soap on a rope. I took a knife and shaved off some of the soap, placed some of the shaved soap on the back of my hand between my thumb and index finger, making it look like it was a drug. He didn't think twice when placing his nose on my hand and snorted it up. Just as he did, leaning back and freaking out, I had the soap on a rope hanging around my wrist, on the other hand. While bending back, because of the shock he felt as the soap went down his nose, I swung the soap into the air, cracking it over his head. He wanted to fight for about 2 hours until he was so high he forgot about the situation. He got so drunk later that night, we ended up behind buildings, in the alleyway. My friend from Michigan was beating him up for being too drunk. This went on for about 2 hours. That ended their friendship, but both of them still wanted to hang out with me. I stopped hanging out with my friend from Michigan, and we didn't part ways on good terms. My quiet friend and I would hang out with the old Mexican friend he had, or walked over to the old Indians we knew, and partied with them. While dating my girlfriend in Mesa, me and my friends, before we went our separate ways, all got together and went out to a pool hall. A couple of blondes, dressed in nice, tight, skin poking out of holes, skirts, came up to us to talk. There was no hesitation, there were two girls and three of us. My friend from Michigan and I took the two girls, and the quiet friend was the fifth wheel. We played pool for a while, took them back to the apartments. After getting back to the apartments, we had sex in the open at the pool sauna, and next to the sauna on the ground. In front of my apartment, which was only across the pool's fence. My sisters were coming outside and bugging us and knew what was going on, but luckily never told my girlfriend. That was my first and only one-night stand. When hanging out with those Indians, I would walk over to their apartment and have a crazy night. I don't even know how I got home some nights, and I ended up attacking my mom one night. Officially becoming my first trip to detox, I was later told I pinned my mother against the wall. I tried to put my knee into her leg after she broke a broom handle over my head. She moved her leg, and my knee went into the drywall, and I busted a hole in the wall behind her. My brother picked me up, forced me into the bathtub, turned the water faucet on, and forced my head under it. When I calmed down, he picked me up and put me in my mother's bed. The cops showed up and talked to my mom, mentioning how my mom should take me to detox, and my mom agreed. They asked me if I was willing to go, I agreed, and we went the next day. That same night my friend got drunk and fell asleep in the front seat of a car in a grocery store parking lot. I was able to attend the trade school, but my grades were falling behind, and traveling between Mesa and Phoenix. I went to detox but gave up and left early. The trade school I attended went out of business, and my family had to move back to the efficiency apartment we had lived in before. I was still stealing but got arrested while intoxicated for shoplifting. I began to hang out with people in Mesa who ran around on motorcycles committing crimes. I helped burglarize houses and still shoplifted to get drunk. Every time I went to Mesa, I had a place to sleep as long as I stole alcohol. The fridge was always full of beer because another guy, and I did beer runs until the fridge was full. One day I decided to steal 8 packs of cigarettes when I couldn't even walk straight. I was ordered to take classes that showed how people who drink and drive die in car accidents. I had to do community service and was on probation until I was 18. I can tell you now looking back, it is all hazy as I sit here typing. So many of my memories occurred and were forgotten. I felt the loneliness inside of me during that last part of my childhood years. I was defiant, in full flight of reality, and didn't even know. In my mind, I was able to conquer the world, and life was mine for the taking. Nobody could stand in my way. I was on probation for the second time, and I never once changed my ways. I still ran the streets, and the old behaviors never went away. I wanted to get in trouble, but went home to see my probation officer, and then leave. If I did stay home, I stayed to myself and wrote poems and stories to escape reality. Thank you. brought to you by The Vine on YouTube and The Storyteller on Facebook. We thank you for your participation. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, share, make comments. We love feedback.